Hey, art family, if you like this one, the full-length version's on Patreon.
They are skillful.
Hello, art family, and thank you to all the new subscribers. I recently took a trip down to Virginia and had some time to sketch this beautiful log cabin. This sketch is 16 by 20. That is an Arches 140-pound cold-pressed watercolor block. And I've taped off around the edges, and it was very hot while I was sketching, so I was constantly having to battle the fact that the paper and the paint were drying much faster than I could put the paint down. So I ended up with a lot of odd textures, but I've come to embrace that sort of thing in my sketching, especially if I'm sketching on location. You can't expect it to be perfect when you're kind of up against the elements. I started out by pre-wetting everything, and then I worked on the sky, even though I knew I was going to set the trees right on top of that. Normally, I would have worked my way down and then set the trees while it was still wet, but by the time I got down to the grass and the gravel, everything had already dried up in the sky. I kept a spray bottle handy to spray both my paint box and the entire sheet that I was working on. I'm trying to work on all my lightest values, using a lot of water in these initial mixes. As I go, I will progressively use less and less water so that the values get darker, and I can try to build form that way. I'm setting in the trees, I'm trying to use a lot of the texture of my natural hair brush by pushing it into the paper or onto the side and letting it lose some of the water and ruffle up the edges and just rake that across to get some texture. I'm using a lot of warmer colors towards the tops of the trees to catch some of the light and the foliage. And anytime I'm doing a forest scene, I often use lavender or cobalt blue as I get towards the bottom. Sometimes cobalt turquoise. I like the, even if it's not actually there in the scene I'm looking at, I like the kind of mystical effect that that gives the forest. If you do that, gives it a lot of depth and a good range that you can play with distant trees. One thing I'm trying to be cautious of placing in these trees is I don't want picket fence trees. A lot of beginner mistakes with trees. Our brain has this need to put things in order, and so people will be putting in trees and they end up looking like picket fences because they're all evenly spaced. So I'm trying to make sure that my trees are leaning different ways. I'm not going to count how many trees are there or render them specifically, but I'm going to have some tilting, some leaning, and then coming and going kind of lost and found to try to allude to the effect that the foliage is kind of intermixed within the trees. I'm placing in this large sort of yellow ochre and burnt sienna silhouette shape of the cabin itself. I'm going to start using yellow ochre and the underfacing planes of the cabin to start to build out the form and sculpt the form as I start to think of things progressively more sculpturally. That's to say, I'm thinking more about the planes that I'm looking at and less about the fact that this is a house. It's important to try to remove yourself from the awareness of the object that you're sketching because the brain also tends to go on autopilot when you're aware of what the object is. Like if you're sketching a portrait, people tend to have a kind of cartoonized version of it, or they'll just sort of paint themselves. Or if you're sketching a car, for example, we have a kind of icon in our mind and our brain will sort of go on autopilot and try to fill in the blanks for us. And you can end up with a kind of flat looking object and not what you're trying to go for. So I'm trying to close one eye and squint at the object I'm looking at and really focus in on the shapes that I'm seeing. You know, a little circle here, cylinder, square there, kind of pizza wedge, pie wedge shapes here and there that I can piece together with the value. I'm also constantly thinking about the way the planes are facing. If they're facing downwards, are they catching the light from the ground, bouncing off the ground and up into those lower facing planes? And I'm going to start to work my way across the whole shape here, using the cast shadow of the distant trees on across the form. I want to try to connect this shadow form because now I'm progressing onto a darker layer here, which means I'm using less water in the mix. So the colors are going to be a little bit darker as they dry. I'm always constantly switching back and forth between cool and warm, in this case ultramarine and burnt sienna, to get these shadows. You sort of lose the color character in a video or in a photograph because you can't quite catch all the color transitions, but as I'm putting in these colors, I'm constantly subtly transitioning from cool to warm, so more blue in some areas to more orange in others, using ultramarine blue and burnt sienna, and then for the darkest darks, I use ultramarine and burnt umber almost straight from the tube, so almost no water in it at all to get the darkest darks that I need. It's important at a certain stage to progress into these darker layers on a sketch, because if you don't get into these darker layers, you end up with a kind of bleached out looking sketch, because things can end up in a much higher range. We have to kind of anchor the sketch by throwing in these darker values because it helps put everything else into perspective. You know, if you were watching the beginning of this video, maybe those trees looked a little bit too dark, but now that I'm actually putting in darker values, and not the darkest values yet, but darker values in general, you can start to really see how light those trees are and how really, really light that sky was in the beginning. It's almost not even there at all anymore because we now have that much broader range and much deeper depth of value. Value's all comparison, so is color. We're always constantly comparing, and as you put down values, it changes the way you see other values. I'm bringing in some suggestions of bushes and foliage here and there, but I want to make sure that my highest concentration of lights and darks and colors are all going to be on my main kind of character of the sketch, the building itself. To finish this off, I'm going to use some white gouache directly from the tube, putting in a little, just a touch of cadmium yellow, just the tiniest bit, and then swirling that into the brush in the tube directly and touching around with a textured sort of splayed out bristle to get those textures for the flowers. And that's going to be it for this watercolor demo of a log cabin down in Virginia. Thanks very much for watching, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.